Hello lads, sorry about that.
That's okay. Right,
all under control.
It's the perils of trying to organise everything at once when you've got a baby putting to bed, doing a bath, and then accidents galore. It's episode 2, season 1 of the FutureSounds FM podcast, and I'm pleased to say we made it back for another instalment. Just want to thank everyone up front for all the positive feedback we got from the first episode, and in particular, the interview that Tom did with Carl from Runners Club. Obviously, it means a lot to know that people are enjoying it so far, but feel free to leave us a 5-star review on your podcast platform. Not only is that going to boost our egos, it's going to help us to reach more listeners. I'm delighted to say that I'm joined once again by Tom and Martin, a.k.a. Patrick Fakeman, and we've got a stacked episode in store for you again. How are you doing, guys? Have you got anything new to report?
Enjoying a delicious kombucha.
I saw you had a kombucha. I don't have a kombucha, but what I will report is I'm super tired. I drove back from your homestead this weekend, Vince, today. So I'm a bit tired, but we're filming this in the evening, so we've got a nice little atmosphere, a nice little casual chat coming.
Little ambience. I've got, I'm drinking, for listeners who care about such things, I'm drinking some orange squash, but I have got a couple of beers downstairs for later. So, yeah, it was good to see you this weekend. You haven't made it up this way to Wales since the summer, so it was good to catch up. So you can meet the baby and that.
It's always nice to dodge the rain.
Yeah, you got quite lucky, to be fair. It's not been the best of weather lately in Wales, but you saw some pretty nice places as well.
Went for some strolling in the countryside, stayed at the Vale something.
Vale Resort, I think, isn't it?
Vale Resort. Very nice place. Yeah, did a bit of a strolling around Barry, of course, which is always a nice and welcoming environment. Yes, yeah. It was good times. But yeah, other than that, very well.
How about you, Tom?
Yeah, girl, I've got exciting news on the horizon. I'm joining the Vaporwave Dad Club.
Yes.
Summer 2022.
Well, congratulations. I mean, obviously, we've already said that, but it's nice to have you break the news on the air, as it were. Yeah, that's public now, yeah. Yeah, it's exciting. I mean, I don't know if you can hear from my voice, it's quite creaky because we've had a few nights in a row where Poppy's not slept as well. And when they get ill, it just disrupts the whole night for sleep and stuff. But yeah, no, I'm all good.
But it was quite nice because I've never seen you in dad mode before. And this weekend I saw you in dad mode. Usually I just see you in bars or
falling
venues
through a merch table or something.
Yeah, something like that. Or just, kind of strolling in the wrong direction on the way home. But it was nice to see you kind of, being responsible.
Yeah, did I pull that off? Did I? I gave
did.
The impression at least.
You did.
Yeah. No, and obviously YouLouis was there, Jay's little boy. So yeah. It was cool. Yeah, the Vapor family. We'll have to get you down as well next time, Tom. Maybe we can do one in person.
Mm-hmm.
Funnily enough, I was going to say, you're like this, Tom. I popped into the Midnight Store yesterday.
Oh, lovely stuff. Is that where you got your orange juice?
It is, yeah. And obviously other things as well, because there's everything and more in the Midnight Store. I get that in there. It's weird how, still the same guy running the shop. I've been thinking for ages, we've got to try and get someone to put it on TripAdvisor. Like, for people who come to Wales, they can make the Vaporwave pilgrimage to the Midnight Store. Mm-hmm. That would be awesome.
Does he know the extent to which he has been the inspiration behind?
Because we'd always
you told him.
Well, I think we explained it to him, and he was quite perplexed. I think it's always like a bit of a mistake. So on the back cover of Midnight Store, there's this sort of cloud ceiling motif, which is based on a different shop, one in North London. And the owners of that shop saw me taking loads of pictures of their ceiling, and they got quite sort of shirty with me about what I was doing. And I was like, oh, we're musicians, we're making a little sort of art project. And I think the guy heard musician and kind of thought I was sort of Ed Sheeran or Adele level.
And probably thought, how can he leverage this financially to his benefit?
Yeah.
Because that's basically what happened when I showed, I think I might have showed him just a picture of the art on my phone for the Midnight Store now. And I think immediately his brain started ticking because their prices are ridiculous. Like if you go on the Google reviews, I don't want to encourage people to leave negative reviews. That's not my style. But if you go on the reviews for the Midnight Store, there's some appalling stuff. Like they say they're open till midnight. They're never open till midnight. Like constantly it'd be like back in 5 and he's back in 45 and the same people are still queuing outside, like waiting for their parcel because whoever it was made the decision to let them be like a pickup point for mail. It was an awful decision. But their prices are proper through the roof. Like they added a COVID surcharge on beers from the start. So it was like £1 a can became £1.50.
Lots of out of date produce as well.
Yeah.
The most recent review though, which was 2 months ago, someone's very happy with their vape, which is ironic, you know, ultimately given what we're discussing, but he seems very happy with his £10 Wicked deal.
Well, you know, this is what we want to see. We want some positive reviews. Maybe we will find someone comes on holiday, ends up in Cardiff, and if they do, just look up the Midnight Store. It is a real place.
Yeah, and according to this, you can get yourself a nice pasty as well.
Probably out of date. I'd steer clear. Have you guys been listening to any new music at all in the last couple of weeks? I managed to stumble across a conversation, a bit of kerfuffle, should we say, on Twitter about Barber Beats. Because to be honest with you, outside of knowing Haircuts for Men's music quite well, I've never really ventured too deep into that kind of subgenre. But I saw a bit of kerfuffle being kicked up about how much transformation's been done with the samples with some of the artists and stuff. And I don't know anything about it, so I'm not venturing an opinion on that. But I thought I'd dig out, well, a latest release. And Macro Blank is someone that people tend to talk about quite a lot. And I listened to this track, Nebula, from an EP that came out on the weekend, and that's damn good. I'd recommend. I'm sure most of you have listened to it already, but it's awesome. So that's my take home for the week.
I'll be honest, I haven't actually, with driving around and traveling and such and work being what it is, not listened to anything particularly new, but I think one that has popped up on the drive home, which pops up quite a lot anyway, and is a bit of a link back to our last episode, is the track You by Bloodwave with Runners Club 95, which is just smooth, soft, good driving music. So I think I played it a couple of times on the way back. So that's probably my pick for this week.
about you, Tom? Discovered anything new?
I've been catching up on releases by Active Presence. This is possibly the worst music to drive to. So he put out an EP at the tail end of last year called Whole New Area. And the track that I particularly like is called Let's Get Lost Tonight. So he put out two records on Business Casual, which is also where Mélonade released their music originally. This is a self-released EP, and he does some really, really messed up things with time. Like, it sounds like he's, you know, manually playing a record player with no electricity. Like, he's just dragging the record along with his finger. It's pretty out there. But I think it's some of the most inventive stuff I've heard in like vaporwave or adjacent vaporwave scene in a long time. So yeah, big up Active Presence.
That's high praise. Why is it so, is it too sketchy to drive to? Is that what it is? It's distracting. Is that kind of?
Well, I think, so it's kind of plunderphonic stuff. But, you know, if you think back to sort of Chuck Person, Echo Jams, you know, the kind of stuff that he's putting in the washing machine is like very smooth music, you know, 80s kind of power ballads, slow jams. This Active Presence, you know, clearly has an interest in, you know, rave stuff and kind of quite out there instrumental hip hop. So, you know, it's got these blissed out textures, but, you know, he's fed quite rhythmic music into that blender, and then he's kind of broken it even further. So, yeah, definitely wouldn't drive to it, but it's an amazing headphone listen.
Another shout out, actually. I'm going to give a shout out to some of our competition, as it were. They've been around a bit longer than us, for sure. But do any of you guys follow or watch the Hot Takes Vaporwave talk show?
Yeah, I've seen it a couple of times, or heard it a couple of times, I should say. Yeah.
Yeah, I've been meaning to get around to watch the Golden Living Room interview for a while, and I caught up with that the other day. And yeah, is it Young Shiro and Skeleton Lipstick that host it? That's right.
Yeah.
I find Golden Living Room a fascinating producer. Obviously, he's one of the OGs, and we've been talking to him for the film. I'm looking forward to getting out there eventually and interviewing him. Obviously, also, we did announce last week the test pressing giveaway. We're going to be releasing Welcome Home, but aside from that, it's definitely worth checking out that episode in particular, because he's someone who's got a really interesting way of coming at production. You know, there's a lot of live performance. He's quite classically trained. In fact, I think, like you, Tom, he might actually be a music teacher.
Yeah, he is. I donated some money to help him buy a classical guitar for his classroom.
Oh, really? That's amazing.
Using a platform called Donors Choose, I think. So I felt obliged to donate some money.
Nice. Was he successful? Did he get the crowd?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, without wanting to get too political, I think it's quite mainstream for educators in America to have to fund their own classroom supplies, which is obviously a terrible state of affairs when, you know, teachers are underpaid anyway. But I was happy to dip into my pocket and get a guitar for his classroom.
Well, that's amazing. But yeah, like I said,
I didn't buy it myself. I think I gave, you know, 20, 30 quid. I'm just saying, not picking myself up too much.
Yeah, you should have left that there. People might have thought that you'd stepped in and saved the day on your own. But
oh yeah, but they'll be asking me for other
days. That's what's going to happen now. Yeah, it'd be like
advertising with my band name, isn't it? It's Donor Lens Business. They think I'm a sort of philanthropic organization.
Yeah. It's like that thing when people win the lottery and suddenly you get bombarded with...
I'll keep that quiet, definitely.
Yeah, I wouldn't be telling no one.
I've always said I wouldn't tell a soul. I wouldn't tell someone until I just rolled up in a Ferrari or something.
Would you be back for episode 3 of this?
Would I, hell? No, I'd pop back in. I just
occasionally
got to keep in touch with the normal folk, and I.
And we're joined on the line by Martin, who's currently in the Seychelles.
Exactly. Like the reception will be awful, but I'll be there.
You'll be there in spirit. Nice, nice. Okay. Well, yeah. What have we got this week then? Martin, do you want to kick off on this one? Because obviously you led the way. I was late for that as well. So.
You were late for that as well, but that's okay. Yeah, we sat down with you, and it was last week now, and chatted all things about his inspirations and what got him into making music, where he'd come from to where he is now, but of course a bit about Lionel release that he had with you guys last year, as well as a bit about the some of the live events that he's had a bit of a hand in organizing pre-COVID, but of course doing his part to get Vaporwave live and Future Funk out there in the other live scene in the UK. So good interview. It was really interesting. He was surrounded by boxes, of course, because he's just moving house, but at the same time he was it's good fun to talk to him.
Can I insert a spoiler alert here? Because for people, we did have a few questions from Club Flamingo members, quite good questions on a range of topics, some more serious than others. We had one from Glenn who asked about what his favourite type of cheese, and spoiler alert, if you're triggered by these things, he's not a fan of cheese or melons. Am I giving too much away?
Very strange, a man that he doesn't like melons. But yeah, please, if you are some kind of cheese lover, please don't write in and complain. Sorry, it's just
we just asked the questions.
We did, yeah.
There we are.
The recording. All right, we'll just get cracking on then. So, Ewan, good afternoon. Thanks for coming along.
Thanks. Good to be here.
Well, I say coming along. It looks like you're in a lounge.
Oh, where I am right now?
Yeah.
Oh, well, funny thing, I'm actually moving house next week.
Right.
So there's a couple of things packed up in boxes.
And you're you're in Scotland, is that right?
No, so I'm down in Nottingham at the moment, but okay. I'm moving back to Scotland.
Whereabouts in Scotland are you going to?
I'm staying with my parents in Stirling for a bit, because I'm looking at purchasing a house in the near future. But that is all tricky and requires logistics.
It does indeed. I, as a kid, I've got a tenuous link to Scotland. As a kid, I'm very much from like the south of England. But as a kid, I spent a bit of time on the Isle of Bute for a little while.
Right.
Which, as a 10 and 11-year-old, there wasn't a huge amount going on. So I think just sort of sitting around. I think I put on loads of weight and then came home. Anyway, we have completely veered off. So thanks for coming on. Of course, this is the Future Sounds FM podcast. So essentially being a bit of a mixture of individuals that might do some presenting on it, but the key part to it is that we're kind of interviewing people that, number one, not only are doing the Future Sounds event this coming March, but anybody that's really involved in Vaporwave and Future Funk and a bit of Synthwave as well. What I wanted to start off with asking, really, which is the key one for me, was I was kind of keen to get a little bit of a history about how Mélonade came, obviously your project Mélonade, how it came to being, number one, how it came into existence and how you've kind of found yourself where you are now.
Yeah, so it started because I'm looking at the date, all of a sudden it's 2022.
Oh, no.
But started roughly 7 years ago now, which is pretty crazy. But I just had a desire when I was younger to make music, so I started, you know, got FL Studio and just started messing around. I had always been a fan of Daft Punk, French house in general. So started down that route. I met Mare No-Tilled, if you've heard of him around, online. And we started with some other people, Cerise Records, which was like a little internet thing where we just kind of made some French house, put it out there, that kind of thing. Started to get a little bit of traction. I discovered the whole Vaporwave Future Funk thing around kind of 2014, 15. Very much liked it. So taking the kind of disco house more towards that route, I then did my self-titled Mélonade album in 2018, which was, it got a big response. It was a success, inverted commas, for me at least. And then, yeah, just been going from there. I did met loads of great people, organized the UK live show in 2019, the Strawberry Station. That was amazing.
There's definitely some questions I know that
indeed, yeah.
Enzo, when he decides to join us, has got he was going to discuss about that. So yeah, that sounds exciting.
Yeah, and then of course I really splash my second album in 2020 now, which is suddenly 2022, as I said. and then we got the vinyl, which was in December, which sold out in like a couple of days, which was also insane. So
that's amazing.
That's the timeline.
How did you find? Because I didn't find Vaporwave until quite later on after that, and I guess it's a bit like its other kind of sort of I don't want to say sister genres, but like the synthwave scene and Vaporwave, they've kind of exploded a bit to the point where some people think they're oversaturated and such. But how were like the Vaporwave and Future Funk scenes back in, you said, 2014?
Yeah, I mean, back then it was, I found it, as many others did, through artsy music and just kind of the way it had spread into internet and anime and music culture a little bit, because artsy music was the focal point for a lot of people finding it on YouTube recommendations. But really, it was just artsy music. It was FutureSize Society Collective. It was a you know, much smaller than it is now, just kind of Macross, St. Pepsi, you know, Phantom's Revenge, who's been doing great stuff recently. But it was much smaller, and there was a much smaller pocket of, quote, big artists. But yeah, I found it through Artsy and then just got on SoundCloud, started putting stuff in there.
How do you found the nature of it now? Because as I say, there's lots more of it out there. People are obviously trying their hand to it. There's still enough sampling to be able to kind of do in the world, but there does come a point sometimes where I don't know whether it's saturation, because I'm still very much exploring future funk and vaporwave to the point where I'm more than satisfied with kind of what I find, but there's still that element of, you know, still having to dig through. Has it, how for you has it changed as an artist in that scene?
Well, talking about saturation, I don't think it's oversaturated, but you could say it is saturated in some regards, especially with future funk. With people starting out, myself and my friends included, when you start out learning sampling or whatever, you tend to be quite lazy through no fault of your own. But once you develop the skill to sample more with more integrity and more skillfully and adding your own spin on things, then the quality goes up. I think there's been an influx of new producers, which is good. But along with that comes the saturation of kind of, I'm hesitant to say lazy, but quite kind of lazy, low effort stuff from the new producers. Again, through no fault of their own, they're just learning.
Yeah.
But if you set the bar for quality high enough, you can really find some good stuff. And there's been some really good albums in the past 2-3 years.
So where are you going now to kind of sort of, you obviously mentioned sort of YouTube and such before. Where are you going now to discover new stuff? Is it, because often a lot of people, I imagine, get sent bits and pieces as well.
But. Yeah, I mean, the big thing over the past year or so has been the official playlist Spotify put up. So there's now official editorial playlist for both Vaporwave and Future Funk. So I'm hoping a lot of people find new stuff through that. I kind of listen through the, I keep up to date on who's on the playlist. It's mostly the big names. A lot of people I know are on there. Usually it's through word of mouth or SoundCloud and Bandcamp that I find new stuff. I've been impressed by Classic Files, Azaria, Hopeless Romantic was an album last year that I very much liked. Kiss Kiss Feel Good by Flammy. I'm just throwing out recommendations for people. were albums which I was super impressed with. So I think as long as you kind of can search enough and search for high enough quality, you're going to find it.
Somewhere. I think that's part of the fun of it as well, isn't it? Is that kind of deep diving into rabbit holes of stuff that's okay, and then suddenly either through like you say, it'll be recommended videos or recommended tracks that come up from whatever platform that you're using. That's tend to be how I found the more more interesting stuff. But yeah, like you say, particularly Bandcamp, you just, you know, typing in whatever genre on there, there's all sorts of weird and wonderfuls on there, definitely.
FutureSounds. Yeah, there, I was just going to say, there's a lot of online live shows going on, and there's a lot more people making mixes. And so through live shows and those mixes, you can also find, you know, artists you haven't listened to before.
And was that anything that you were involved in? Did you do sort of along the, during the COVID train, as it were, that people sort of trying to throw stuff out there?
Mixes
or whatever.
I did a couple of mixes. One was for Disco Forever, that show. And then I did one for Daydream Deluxe's birthday one. I've been quite busy with work and house purchase and moving house and
big music life stuff.
And I'm also releasing a game on Steam in like 2 weeks.
Oh, you?
So I was developing my own game, but yeah.
Is that in addition to just your day job?
Yeah, that's in addition. Game stuff. Okay. So I do programming for the video game studio 9 to 5, and then I did my own game in spare time as well. So.
Sleep involved in there anywhere?
Yeah, occasionally.
Excellent. We, for the purpose of the recording, Vince has arrived. Enzo, hello, how are you?
All right, sorry, chaps. I got caught in the worst traffic I've ever experienced. But that's another story, I guess.
That is. We were just, we'd started off chatting a little bit about the history of the project and then a bit more around kind of the scene now, how it compares to maybe 2014 when Ewan had first started off and started discovering it. And then you popped in.
Yeah. Well, I rudely interrupted you.
Absolutely fine. No worries at all. I was going to ask, it's probably good timing, actually, because I think you talked about, as part of the history of it, you mentioned the work that you guys did to get the record out. I think it was the back end of last year in the December. I was kind of interested between the two of you as to how that came about.
We had a good response from... The album was originally on Business Casual. And we had done some tapes and it had a good response. But I don't know where you saw the album first, Vince?
The same. I mean, I follow Business Casual a lot. Shouts to John Zabil. It's an amazing label. They put stuff out every week and it's such high quality, high standard. And I'd already heard your stuff, obviously. And that album, I had it bookmarked from the second it came out. I think the tape sold out before I got a chance to get one. But yeah, as soon as you said about putting it onto to Wax, yeah, 100%. We jumped at the chance, to be fair. And we'd met you at the Groove Horizons event.
Yeah, that was great.
Many moons before that. But the process was quite tortured because it took so long.
Yeah, it was... I don't know how long it took from inception to pressing, but...
Yeah, I guess a lot of these issues are... Everyone's talking about the Adele pressing. 500,000 records of a new album, which has caused the latest blockage. But things were already causing problems because of COVID. People were having to shut down for quite a period and there'd be reduced staff in pressing plants and stuff. And so waits had gone from maybe 8 to 10 weeks when we first started talking about it, suddenly waiting 6 months. And if you do pre-orders, then that's a real problem for those labels because they've got a backlog of orders for many, many months. And for us, because we try and do things up front, it means a lot of cash tied up and a lot of time saying, sorry, Ewan, it's not ready yet. It's going to be ready soon.
This question is going to be slightly off topic, but I'll ask it. I think it's important. Is there a view that, given that, well, I don't know how far in or out of this we are at the moment, that things could improve in that sense? The pressing plants getting back to some kind of normality.
Funnily enough, I got an email from Jill from Media Duplication, do a lot of tapes for Vaporwave labels and Synthwave labels. And she recommended this blog post, actually more of a podcast that was on BBC, BBC Sounds. And there's been a new UK pressing plant that's been established as a reaction to this issue, primarily to work on small runs with, you know, minor labels and artists and stuff. So locally, yeah, that could be a real game changer for us. But in generally speaking, there's not an immediate sign that waits are getting shorter. So I don't know. It's just fingers crossed.
It is what it is. Cool. Okay, thanks. Ewan, I was going to ask you whether you'd, in terms of, because I guess with the whole, you mentioned you've got some friendships with artists that are kind of out there within future funk scene, vaporwave scene, doing what they do. Have you got many kind of does that extend to in real life, or kind of your kind of family and in real life friends aware of what you do and how that kind of how that plays out in terms of they're interested or what they think of your music?
Yeah, I mean, generally we have a we kind of call it the UK gang, which is myself, Strawberry Station, Mr. Wax, Conscious Thoughts, F.X is in Glasgow as well, and there's others. I think most of them live in London, in England. I'm moving back up now, which is a shame. But yeah, I've met them numerous times. Myself and Strawberry, we were with the Flamingo fellas for the recording.
It was quite recently, wasn't it? Yeah.
I don't know if I can mention that as something special.
Yeah, you can. No, it's okay. Yeah, no, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah, but we've met up numerous times, and it's always a great time. It's always fantastic. We can share stuff, and yeah,
good. I think it's important because you find so many that people are kind of, well, there's, I don't want to use the phrase bedroom producers because I think it minimizes what people do, but I think the time that we're in now has expanded people's ability to kind of, although we've had restrictions, that people are meeting up more, kind of engaging with that kind of in real life element to it, so that online acquaintances are becoming friends, particularly in sort of smaller, more niche scenes. It's good.
For sure.
Do you know a good example of that was Electronicon, 100% Electronica's first live event. My brother and I managed to get out there to New York for the first one, and it was mad just how many people. It was a conversation that kept happening all day, people talking about this is the Woodstock of vaporwave, and how all these people were people who had been good friends online for a long, long time, finally getting to meet in person in real life. And it was the same with that Groove Horizons event. I know I'm dropping that one back in there again, but I think it's important, especially as you're talking about UK artists. You guys recognize the demand, same as 100% did. And you kind of, as a collective, you pull together the first UK event. And all the people that I met on that night as well were talking about how great it was to jump off the computer screen and meet people in real life, and how much a part of the scene that's becoming. Hopefully, we'll get back to that. It's kind of the trajectory we were heading on before COVID.
So that's segue heaven for me, because Groove Horizons is going to be my next question about how that ultimately came about, and ideas in terms of, again, bringing it to fruition. How did that get to
it was really the brainchild of myself and Strawberry Station, Jacob. We had seen online on the subreddits, and we were also involved in Discord at the time, of people generally wanting a live show, but there was quite a few UK people. So we just kind of thought, screw it, let's go for it, let's make something happen. We got a great amount of help. Shout out to Alexander Hall, who was in London. He works for a lighting company, and he had set us up with, you know, he knew some people at venues and knew a bit more about the organization. But with the UK gang, inverted commas, that I mentioned, we managed to pull together some cash to do the show. It was kind of a bit scary because we didn't know if people would show up. Yeah. But they did. And there was people coming in on the day who were also not part of, you know, the whole vaporwave and future trunk thing, and they came in and they said they enjoyed it, which was great. So the event was a success, and yeah.
Do you think you would have followed up with another event by now if it wasn't for the event, we'll call it?
Yes. We had plans for Groove Horizons 2 in 2020. Obviously didn't come to fruition. We would have liked to have done it in 2021, but I think as you know, it was still lingering quite heavily, and we were all busy with things that didn't happen. So I think we definitely would have followed up with something, but we're hoping to either do something in the future or just continue doing different shows.
I do think there's an element to, and I can only really speak for the UK, for anyone that's obviously listening elsewhere, I think that people are in quite different situations, but there is more of a confidence here around getting out about and doing a little bit more. And I think Vince, I was saying beforehand that with the postponement of the FutureSounds event, which was the right thing to do, I think the irony of it is that the restrictions are lesser now than they ever would have been before we even, you know, conceived of doing it in the first place. But it's still, I think it allows people, 2022, I think, will settle, hopefully settle, so that individuals feel nice and comfortable, artists feel comfortable, you can get good crowds in, which ultimately is good. Like you say, is what you want is will people show?
Yeah, I mean, we could have done the event as planned. I think we did make the right call. You're right. It was a real... We wrestled long and hard over whether to postpone or not. But I think what we've also got a benefit of is that by the time we do the event on March the 26th, I keep getting the date confused, the weather will be a little bit milder and there's a bit of an outdoor space at this venue as well. So for people who are a bit more concerned and want to be able to nip outside and get some fresh air and sort of remove themselves from being indoors in large numbers, you know, it gives us that option, which we didn't necessarily have at the first venue. But it's all good, and we're looking forward to seeing you play. And you haven't played live for a while, have you? So,
no, not since the Groove Horizons. I've got a new fancy controller, and I've been going through, so I'm all set and raring to go. But yeah, I'm very excited.
Excellent. That's what we want to hear. What I thought I'd do then is the MPF fan club. And Enzo, you have to tell me, is it pronounced just Club Flamingo?
Because it's spelling, which is Welsh. Yeah, I got asked if we'd done some vaporwave thing with the CLWB and then the two Fs. But actually, Club Flamingo. And if you do one F, it's only a V sound in Welsh. So it'd be Club Flamingo if we didn't have the two Fs. So the double Fs makes it an F sound. It's not the same alphabet as our language. So yeah, Club Flamingo,
there you go. So that's explained for people, so they don't need to ask you again.
Yeah, that's, yeah, thanks for that chance. Yeah,
no, you're right. So in the run-up to ourselves meeting today is that a message was sent out for people that were in the fan club to ask if they had any questions for you, Ewan, and there are six or seven in there that range in their interest and, I guess you could say, subject matter. So I'll go with some of the more music-based ones, and then we'll lean into the ones that might be more dairy-based. Let's put it that way. We'll go from there. So the first question was from Drake31217. And hi, Drake. I hope you're listening because your question's coming. So the question from Drake was, what's your favorite sample that you've ever used? And then in brackets, they've written, and following on from that, how do you tend to seek out your source material? Are you a YouTube deep diver? So actually, there's three questions there.
Yeah, this is multiple questions. So the favorite sample, I mean, I've used a lot now. I think I have to go with, which was just the most fun, which was a sample of the Hitler rap by Mel Brooks. So I sampled that on Take It to the Top, which was on a self-titled. And go and listen to, for anyone listening, go and listen to the original because it's actually really good. but yeah, it's this Nazi parody song from Mel Brooks. And in the middle, there's this kind of almost choir-like section. So just take that, loop it, make it into a house song. But it was just really, really fun to use. And I think... the kind of absurdity of sampling something like that was also part of the fun.
I didn't expect you to say Hitler or Nazis in the response to that question.
No, but there's nuance and context.
Yeah, I mean on Splash there's a sample from a Burger King advert as well, which was also fun. But yeah, so the second part of that was
how do you tend to seek out the source material?
Yes. So YouTube deep diving is the main thing. I have my friend James, his artist name is Kujo, he's really great, he works with me for finding samples. We trade stuff back and forth a lot, we experiment quite a lot. He has a nice method of going through YouTube stuff, which kind of exploits the algorithm, so you have to make a fresh account so that you don't get any, you know, personal recommendations or whatever. And then if you just kind of click through channels of the most obscure recommended, so you get a recommended video, you click on it, as obscure as you can get, you go to their channel, and then you sort their uploads, and then pick like the most obscure of those. And if you just keep doing that, the algorithm leads you down to videos of random obscure 80s funk which have like 70 views. So you can sometimes find really obscure, really good stuff. Apart from that, I have had a couple of visits to record shops. Shout out to Le Freak Records in Dundee. They have a great shop. They stocked some of my self-titled, which is great. So I have gone to record shops occasionally, but it is just faster to go through stuff digitally.
Are you, if you don't mind me jumping in there, are you sampling from, have you sampled from vinyls direct?
I think there was one which I did, but I cannot remember which one, so apologies for that. I think it was on, it might have been on the K Hits 97 thing I did, but I can't remember. So I've done it once or twice.
Very quick clarification, if I may. The first part of the question was Drake 31217. I'm going to take credit for the second part. I don't want to impose the brackets and the follow-up question to him. He may not have been going down that road, but I was adding that as notes. It's my poor research. My poor comms mind. So
that's okay. You didn't warn me, Dev, but it's out there now.
Yes. And so is Ewan's secret recipe for finding samples, which I'm
yeah, there you go. You guys can use that and take all the good ones. No?
It does make sense. Otherwise, I'd end up with all sorts of, particularly if you were kind of just, like you say, using existing algorithms. Half of mine would be for ramen recipes and things like that. So
I mean, when I do sample things, I often just check whosampled.com just to make sure it's not been used in any big thing. Because I would see The Weeknd recently sampled some city pop songs. So yeah. I always just want to make sure of that.
I think some of the city pop scene have done what some of the synthwave scene did when he was doing similar sorts of things. They're up in arms about how awful and terrible it is. When ironically, it's exposing that music to a much wider audience. So I think I'm all for that.
I definitely think you're right on the city pop side of things. That sample, because I think that the source material for that is so clear that people may well seek out city pop records. I think the beef that people had with The Weeknd's heavily synth-based track is that he's not name-checked or referenced it. So actually, in some respects, people just think, oh, wow, look at this track by The Weeknd. Doesn't this sound amazing in French? When people have been doing it for a decade. And there's not necessarily going to help people find more music like it. But I think with the city pop sample, for sure, loads of people have been talking about what it comes from. And it probably has opened a lot more eyes onto that style of music, which has sort of been bubbling around on YouTube algorithms for the last few years.
Absolutely. Fab. Thanks for that, Drake. That was
good questions.
They were good questions, even though obviously you read them in such a way that was Vince's impact on how I read them. Second question was from Vinyl Collector. And Vinyl Collector asked, outside of Future Funk production, do you have any other projects and do you have any formal music education or skill with instruments?
Mm-hmm. So in terms of other projects, I've done some kind of hip hop / chill hop things in the past. Mm-hmm. Most successful one was Dream Plaza, which had a good response. So I did some tapes with Corspect. I do often do, I have a couple of hip hop, chill hop songs stored away, which I might release at some point. They don't really fit with the main kind of disco house future funk stuff that I do. K Hits 97 was an attempt at a bigger kind of project with hip hop or chill hop, whichever. But I might release something like my friend Pop Up actually did a kind of hip hop collection. It's called Songs for Distance. But I might do something similar to that soon. And then there was a second part to that, which was
It was about musical education in terms of a formal sort of.
So the short answer is no. I used to have piano lessons when I was like 9, which I did for a couple of years, and I like hated them. And I also did. We had music at high school, but it wasn't so much music. It was like everyone get on your Casio keyboards and play "Stand by Me" for like the 20th time. So essentially, no. I have a MIDI keyboard and a bass guitar, which I can kind of riff on, and I use them to. If I'm working on a bass line, I can just. It's a lot easier to just make to play the bass line rather than draw the notes in FL, so I can just riff with that and work it out. So I don't play anything in inverted commas, but I do use keyboard and bass guitar for production.
All right, thank you very much indeed. So this one you may have partly answered before, but I'll throw it out there just in case there's anything that you want to add to it. So Vapor Gaze asks, how did you discover Future Funk, and is there an artist or a group of artists that inspired you to go into production? And you mentioned a couple of names earlier on from 2014.
Yeah, so again, the focal point was artsy music. I think a lot of people around then found it through artsy music. I basically just got a recommendation of an anime GIF on my box one day, and I was like, oh, what is that? That's quite cool. I think, as I remember, the song was a really lazy flip of a Delegation sample. But I can't remember the artist, but it's quite ironic, but that's how I discovered it. Our artists starting out, obviously Daft Punk is a huge inspiration to kind of most people, so I don't need to mention them, but artists like Phantom's Revenge. I really liked his quite hard-hitting disco house / French house. Sim Gratina / he has a French house alias called Frenssu. Not a lot of people mention him, but he was very influential on me, and he sampled a lot of stuff before everyone else that I've noticed they've kind of sampled now. And also Louis La Roche. His stuff is less sampled and more original now, but he had previously released the Peach EP, which was mistaken online to be Thomas Bangalter's work. And he kind of blew up because of that. And he also did an EP called Me and Her, which is really fantastic if no one's listened to that. So I'd say those three, really, Phantom's Revenge, Louis La Roche, and Sim Gratina are the three big ones.
Excellent. I won't lie. I don't think I've heard any of those, so I think I'll have to Google.
We can link them in the description, I think, because quite a few people might fancy taking a little track back and checking them out. So, we'll try and get links in the description for people.
All right, so we're down to the last three. Jack D, who it's Jack Dyson from Space Jams. I think that's Jack. I assume that's Jack Dyson from Space Jams, right? It is. I'm getting a nod. Again, we touched upon this earlier on, and I think I probably know your answer to this, but Jack asked, do you feel there's a potential for Future Funk to get a growing live scene in the UK? So I can envisage that your answer will be on this one.
I think the trajectory is there. I think the question is just how high the trajectory goes, sort of thing. Mm. Certainly on the night in Groove Horizons, we did have not a huge amount of people, but we did have some people who saw the pink aesthetic lights and were quite curious and came in and had a good time. So I think if people are open to it, then it's certainly a possibility.
All right. And then we have, here we go, Young Clean. He or she's put a scenario out here. So you're in your studio putting first touches to a track. What comes first? And how far do you go with the idea before discarding it and moving on to something new? That's the first part of the question. So I'll let you answer that first.
First part of the question. Usually with the sample, I get it in. I listen to the bits I want to use quite closely. I isolate them and just play around with those, whether it be chopping them up, moving them about, pitch stretching, putting them with other things I've got. So really I focus on the sample first. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, the drums really is the next bit that decide what comes later, whether it's just four on the floor or it's more kind of hip hoppy or something more complex. So I put the drums on top of that, and then if it's working well there, then I kind of go on and either add a bass line if it needs it or a synth line and just do the structure of the song generally and work out what I want to do with this song. What is this song going to be? Once I add drums to the sample, and if I try a lot of things with chops with the sample and moving it around it, if I can't find a structure, I wouldn't say I discard them. I kind of zip them up and put them in a rejects pile, so that if I come back to it later, I might think of something else. But usually it's at the point where I've messed with the sample, I've done some drums, it's not really working, let's just bank that and move on.
So that does...
It sounds like he's answered part two already in a way.
You may have done part two was, is your hard drive littered with unfinished demos like mine? Or are they pretty sure, or are you pretty sure for the moment you find a sample that's going to work?
I don't think there's very few times where you find a sample and you know it's going to work. There's only been like one or two times where that's happened. I mentioned Take It to the Top. That was one sample, which as soon as you loop it, it's got that je ne sais quoi that you know is just going to work, but it's quite rare that that happens. A lot of the time I have to mess with it, as I said, structure, chop it to see if it would work. I have a lot of I'm working on the next album at the moment. I have a lot of discarded and unused stuff, so I would say it's littered, but my hard drive is very big, so that's not an issue.
Kind of inevitable follow-up, because I guess whenever you talk to Vaporwave or Future Funk artists, the subject of sampling is going to come up a lot. And you've referred to it quite a few times, like your process and stuff. But from more of an industry point of view, do you think, and we did talk about this when we filmed you and Jacob, Strawberry Station, for Nobody Here. Do you think that copyright and sampling is a bigger issue now than it was? Kind of how do you think you get around that? Because one of the ways of getting around it, obviously, is to go the professional route, like Young Bay has, signed to Sony or a sub-label of Sony and given free rein, effectively, to use whatever's in their back catalogue. But for most of us, we don't really have an easy way to clear samples. I mean, do you have any thoughts about that issue and where the scene might go because of it?
Yeah, I mean, as you mentioned, there's artists like Sam Pepsi getting signed. I saw Vantage, his song 50-50 blew up and he got that signed. So I think even though it's becoming more of an inverted commas problem for artists who get bigger, I think weirdly enough, the bigger labels have looked at it and said, we will be forgiving simply because we can make so much money off of it. If they see the money, they are kind of willing to forgive. So, I think as long as the large labels remain open to officially signing and encouraging the music as opposed to suing and discouraging the music, then I think that's a positive sign.
Do you think we are reaching kind of a crossroads with that? I mean, for example, just post one apocalyptic scenario, Bandcamp changes its process and starts to use algorithms to shut down sample-based music that's not cleared. I mean, what happens to the music if that happens?
Yeah, that's a tricky one. I certainly think that would be a bad scenario. But I also think in response to that, I'm pretty sure someone would then make another site. There's always going to be another site. So I think that would be detrimental for sure. And I think a lot of stuff would be lost. But as long as people keep their archives, then it wouldn't be too bad. But really, we just have to see how it goes. If that happens. Hopefully it doesn't. But
yeah, fingers crossed it doesn't. Otherwise, we're all going to be a little bit more sad.
Save your files, guys. Archive, save your project files. Because I lost some stuff, so PSA. Oh. Thanks.
All right, and the last one is from last question from Glenn Jones. So this is slightly different, but he asks, "What's your favorite cheese, and how do you like it served?"
So I'm not a big cheese person. Soft cheeses like brie are really just disgusting to me. Just. Not going to sugarcoat it. They're disgusting to me. Any cheese like Stilton, again, just disgust me. I'm just like, give me a mature cheddar on like an oat cake. And that's me. I'm a very kind of plain cheese person.
No cheese table at the Future Sounds gig then?
I mean, you can have a cheese table as long as there is just some nice mature cheddar or something. Or a Red Leicester.
Is that your rider? Is it as simple as that? A couple of beers and some mature cheddar and oat cakes.
Yeah, probably. That sounds good.
Very wholesome, actually.
I got one more silly question. Mm-hmm. When we were warming up, trying to get because obviously when you're setting up to film, you've got a, there's a lot of dead time to fill while you're getting all the angles right. And the director of Nobody Here pitted, and this might never come to light, so that's why I'm putting the question to, he pitted Ewan and Jacob against each other, strawberries and melons, which one's better and why? Tell us, rehash that debate. Why is melon better than strawberry? We'll ask Jacob to fight back in a future episode.
I mean, I'll say this on the podcast, simply to be transparent. I don't actually like melon that much. you know, it's all right. It's a decent fruit. But really, I just prefer star fruit. Star fruit is really tasty, but you can't get it in the UK. Mm. I've only had it a few times. I'd say I do prefer watermelon to strawberries simply because the seeds on strawberries can be quite annoying if they're too large. But, you know, they're both nice.
That podcast title right there, Melonade in Don't Like Melon, shocker.
Exposed.
I'll have to be the one. Thank you to the guys at the NPF fan club for throwing out the questions, because I think they were definitely interesting. And
if you have any more foods, fruit, cheese, drink, or related questions, send them to ewan.mountson@btinternet.com.
There you go. Definitely. So yeah, don't be shy. In terms of that, it doesn't have to be fruit, doesn't have to be cheese, it can be meat based, whatever you want,
but or a combination of them all.
Indeed, definitely. Fab, thank you. I think the main thing for me was just it was great to meet you. Looking forward to
catching you at
the event as well. Yeah, it's gonna be really good. So good, but also, you know, good luck with the move, because that's not a it's not a close move. It's not like you just moved up the street.
It's quite a long way, so hopefully it goes well.
Excellent. And was there anything in terms of throwing out any links, be it Bandcamp or any kind of platforms that where people can find your stuff?
I mean, the main two places are my SoundCloud and my Spotify. So it's SoundCloud/melon-aid. And if you just search for Melonade on Spotify, I'm there as well. I'm working on the next album, but progress is slow because I'm busy. So please wait for it. But huge shout out to everyone who bought the vinyl as well, because that sold out insanely fast and that was a great response. So thank you everyone for that. And there may be some signed copies to come, but I don't know what we're doing with those. So
yeah. all in good time. But we did all the orders, and there's a handful of each variant which we're about to put live. So by the time this podcast goes live, there'll be a couple of copies left of both variants. So mypetflamingo.com, check out Splash if you haven't listened to it. Yeah, it's an amazing album.
Excellent. And of course, to catch Ewan playing live, that's the 26th of March 2022 in London at the Post Bar for Future Sounds New Dimension. And you can get tickets at future-sound.co.uk. .co.uk. Come and join us, because it'll be a new venue, slightly bigger, and
it's gonna be a merch table, I assume. People can buy stuff. Amazing.
For sure.
Definitely. Gentlemen, thank you, and I'm sure we'll catch you soon.
Thank you.
See you on the other side. Cheers, guys. We'll be right back.
There you go. That was our interview with Mélonade, and of course the mix that he was kind enough to send over to us. Hope everyone enjoyed it. I know I certainly did. And again, as I say before, big thank you to Ewan for taking the time to have a bit of a chat with us whilst he was in the middle of the stress of moving house. But it was good to catch up, and of course certainly good, looking forward to meeting him in a couple of months.
And it was also good to get questions in from fan club members, because it helps us to, you know, make sure that people are happy. You know, we're asking the right questions, I guess. And there were some revelations in there for sure. The one that really kind of intrigued me, I know I said it at the time, but it's this way of cheating the algorithm on YouTube, because if you don't create a burner account, you're just going to be refed the same stuff you watch. So in my case, that's going to be a lot of Vaporwave, a lot of Synthwave, and a lot of Tottenham Hotspur videos. Like, I get a lot of that kind of, that's going to be pushed back at me constantly. And, you know, if you start searching Plastic Love, you're going to get a load of city pop that comes your way. Mm. And he was saying, if you're looking for a specific type of sound, create a burner account, start afresh. And that's the way you cheat kind of in the short term, the algorithm, which was mad. I'd never really thought of that.
Just, it just means you've got to try and remember all your logins. Although I suppose or creating loads of different email accounts, but it's clearly worth it in the end to get, particularly when he was talking about how he'd found these old kind of R&B tracks. I think he said R&B tracks, but had like sort of 15 views on them. So these quite random ones that people wouldn't have sampled before, which I think is quite important to him.
For sure, for sure. Tom, what about you? I mean, you're not you don't listen to a huge amount of Future Funk, do you?
I'm not a Future Funk guy as such, but, you know, I am a Vaporwave artist, and the parallels are huge. But I think even more than that, you know, I really, the music I listen to in the main is old disco stuff and early house records. And, you know, there's clearly a large amount of crossover with Future Funk. I get the impression from the interview and the mix and Mélonade's own music that, you know, his interests lie in a similar place as well. And, from listening to this music, it's clear that he's an excellent technician. He's got like an amazing technique of sample hunting, which is an art in itself. Definitely going to steal this burner account technique. And really enjoyed getting to know a little bit more about music that I don't know a huge amount about.
Yeah. So a lot of that was how I felt about it as well. And he's an interesting character as well. He was lovely to meet in person when we did the filming with him and Jacob, Strawberry Station. And, you know, they're both important characters in pushing the UK side of things. Obviously a handful or a collection of UK artists that are doing big things, like Eve.exe and Meltnet, others like that, who are really pushing the scene. And it's good to have him on board for Future Sounds. So we can plug that again. Tickets are available March the 26th at the Post Bar in Tottenham.
Absolutely. Future-sounds.co.uk. Go and grab yourself a ticket. We've got it's a great mix of synthwave and vaporwave artists. So even if there's a few artists there you might not have heard of before, come on down. It'll be an exploratory experience as well as a fun night.
What have you guys got planned for the rest of the evening? I'm going to put my feet up and watch a bit of TV and have a beer.
I'm going to edit some podcasts, I think.
It's Premier League deadline day, isn't it?
So yeah, see if Spurs, frantic
Spurs
activity.
Can sign anyone else. Yeah. That's my evening plan. What about you, Martin?
I might watch a movie. I might see...
On a Monday evening?
Yeah, I watch quite a lot of movies, but I've finished Ozark now, so I need something else in life to fill the void.
No spoilers, so, yeah. But is the latest series any good?
In one non-spoiler word, yes. And as usual with Ozark, the last episode before the cliffhangers have you with your mouth and your jaw wide open, and then they make you wait a few more months again. So I enjoyed it. I'm sure others would as well. As an Ozark fan, I really enjoyed it. Yeah.
I started watching with Poppy in the morning. When I take her down, normally about 7 in the morning, I stick on the iPad and I've just blitzed through Parks and Recreation, The American Office, a few other series like that. And I've just started the new series of Cobra Kai, which I'm really enjoying.
That's really good. Yeah.
It's nostalgic, childish fun, but it's great. I love it.
And the soundtrack for that has definitely been cranked up a notch. The score this season for that has definitely been cranked up a notch or more on that. It's a good show. It's really enjoyable.
Did you notice? I love the fact they dropped in that track from Bill and Ted, Two Heads Are Better Than One.
Yeah.
I love that tune. That's like my childhood, like in a soundtrack. I absolutely love it.
I had this is a bit of a shameless plug here. I did there's a Fakeman interview on pearson.com with one of the guys that does the score for Cobra Kai, Zach Robinson, who's also known as, he's a synthwave artist DAD as well. So people should go and check that out if they want to hear more. But it's kind of a year old now, but you know, still worth its time.
Well, we can put a few links. There were a few tracks and references, obviously, that Mélonade gave in his interview, and we've kind of recommended a few tracks in the first part of the show. So we can drop a few links.
We'll chuck that in there as well. All right, that sounds good to me.
Give your website a bit of a bump.
Let's do that.
Anything more from you, Tom, or should we sign off till the next time?
I need to get cracking with my vegan chili.
Oh, that's nice. I had a nasi goreng this evening, which is vegan as well. No, it's not vegan if it's got egg.
No, vegan.
Everything else was
two G's and you're good. Vegan, yeah.
There we go. Cool. All right, we'll see you next time.
Thanks, gents.
See ya.